G'day, I'm Tim Harcourt. Welcome to the Economics of Everything. Well, this time we're going to do something a little bit different. We're going to look at the economics of franchising with Jenny Buchan. When you think about it, there's McDonald's, there's Gloria Jean's, there's Muffin Break. They're companies so well known all over the world, but the law of franchising and the economics of franchising, both in Australia, New Zealand, America and around the world, is actually very complicated. Jenny Buchan's written this great new book on franchising, so we're going to have a little talk to her about the implications of franchising and what they mean for the Australian economy. Great, well, I'm here with Jenny Buchan from the Taxation and Business Law Department, and we're going to talk about franchising, which is your great passion. Now, tell us about franchising. It's basically small and medium-sized businesses. It's basically what they do, isn't it?
Yeah, franchising small, medium and big businesses, and it's a franchisor comes up with a fantastic idea, an entrepreneur comes up with a wonderful way of doing something, they find that there's a spot in the market, they develop a business and then they sell the opportunities to franchisees to clone what they've come up with. Well, more than use the brand, to completely clone the entire offering.
So when you think about franchises, the real famous ones, what is it? McDonald's, Gloria Jean's.
McDonald's, Gloria Jean's, Hair House Warehouse.
The Wiggles, are they a franchise?
The Wiggles are not a franchise.
They're
the
not.
Wiggles
this
are licensed. Yeah, it's a myth. The Wiggles license the use of their products and they grant licenses to people to manufacture Dorothy and Captain
Feathersword.
And all those important characters.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wag the dogs. Yeah. So they grant licenses and then the people who are manufacturing, they have an opportunity to manufacture for other people as well. So they're not constrained, they're not dependent fully on the Wiggles for their business. They can develop other businesses and manufacture for other people alongside.
So it's quite different. When those American footballers in the NFL come out and say, you know, the Pittsburgh Steelers or, you know, Dallas Cowboys have won the Super Bowl and they go, this is a great day in the history of our franchise.
That's another kind of franchise. So the franchise that I'm interested in is a business format franchise.
Okay.
And it's very much a creature of post-World War II.
Yes. Because, I mean, call me old-fashioned, I call them a footy club. And they're not a franchise, are they? Because you don't have Dallas Cowboys popping up everywhere, do you?
No, you don't.
Thank goodness.
An entirely different thing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So that's a different term that you use, franchise.
Yeah.
So the value of franchising in the Australian economy, it's quite a lot of businesses now, isn't it?
It's about 73,000 small businesses. It's about 13% of Australia's GDP is generated through franchises.
So it's not small beer?
It's not small beer.
And it's a big employer, I assume.
It's a huge employer. About 400,000 or 500,000 people are employed in franchising. So it's a serious employer.
And it would be, it would be a serious deal internationally now, wouldn't it? With our close ties now to Singapore, New Zealand, Southeast Asia. You know, when I travel around, I see Gloria Jean's all over Asia and Cookie Man and all these places.
It is huge. Probably 80% of Australian franchisors have the intention of expanding overseas. And it's an incredibly common thing. I mean, McDonald's came from the US. Gloria Jean's came from overseas. Muffin Break came from Canada.
Right.
So it's very much a global business model. You grow out of your own country if you're a good franchisor. And you have to go overseas in order to expand.
And Gloria Jean's was actually an American franchise that they bought, didn't they?
Yeah, the Australians did such a great job that they bought the Americans out. And that also happened for Muffin Break. Muffin Break said after a while, we're not getting the support that we need, so how about we just take over?
Because you can go to India, you can go into a Westfield built, Leighton's built shopping mall in India, and you'll see Clark Shoes, Cookie Man, get a coffee at Gloria Jean's, away you go. I mean, it's quite...
Franchising in many ways must be a dream come true for the big landlords, because it means they can negotiate with the franchisor, they know the franchisor, they know what they do, and they know that they will select an appropriate person to actually be on the ground in the centre.
Now, let's talk about your book. This is Franchisees as Consumers. Now, tell us about the Jenny Buchan story, your passion for this, for the book, for the research, how you went from your high-flying corporate law career to the university. How did it all come about? Where did your passion come from?
So I had the opportunity to move to academia. And of course, because I was so interested in franchising, it's been a logical thing to follow through. Once I moved to academia, my first grant was in relation to CPA Australia gave me some money to look at franchise or failure.
So the Communist Party of Australia? The other one, certified. Okay.
They're probably as well funded.
Yeah.
Anyway, CPA Australia gave me this lovely grant right on the back of Ansett failing.
Right.
Because Ansett... I became really interested in insolvency because Ansett owned Travelland and Travelland was a franchisor.
Sure.
So Travelland had 270 franchisees and 100 company-owned stores, and Ansett had about 42 fully owned subsidiaries, of which Travelland was one. And all of the story was about the employees of Ansett, the poor employees of Ansett, who were admittedly having a rough trot.
They sure did.
But, and amongst it all, there was this 270 people, franchisees, who'd invested a couple of $100,000 and lost a business.
And blow their dough,
And what did their what prospects did their employees face?
So they had employee entitlements as well.
So the ones that stayed in business or that got picked up by other brands found themselves collecting that airport, that $10 surcharge on every ticket so that they could bail out the employees of Ansett. Fair cop, but it really stuck in their craw because they at the same time were bleeding and had been unacknowledged. So I became very interested in that franchise or failure story.
Oh, so it was almost the knock-on effect because people know about Ansett, they know about Ansett's employees, but all the rest of the second order effects are quite enormous as well.
Absolutely invisible.
Yeah.
Trevor Sykes wrote about them briefly.
Yeah.
But apart from that, they were pretty invisible. So my research was hit the front page of the Fin and caused a huge stir.
So their failure was your success?
Well, it was the beginning of
my
major.
Yeah.
You know, if you get enough pushback about something, you know there's something there.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of pushback about my research. You know, there was a lot of opportunity, a lot of interest in discrediting the messenger.
Yes.
But of course, the message was very powerful. And so over the years then I've just built more and more and come to understand more and more about how incredibly complex the relationship between the franchisor, the franchisee, the landlords, the owners of the brands who are typically not the franchisors. So McDonald's doesn't own their brand, it's McDonald's owned subsidiaries, for example.
Right.
And so if McDonald's were to strike hard financial times, the brand would be safe and it would be out of the reach of the liquidators.
So in many ways, I mean, it was a terrible thing what happened with Ansett, but if it led to your research looking at the impact on franchises, when we get another corporate collapse in Australia, you've got, with the book, the principles, the case law, basically all set up to go.
Huge amount more evidence is now available for the government to make informed policy to respond to some very real issues.
So this has made a real difference to Australian public policy and national life, when there's other business failures, you know.
When there's franchise failures.
Yeah.
In my book, I've identified very clearly where the problems are in the franchise model from the perspective of the law. So the main problems are in insolvency and corporate governance, because the directors of the franchisor owe no directors' duties to franchisees.
And economically, I mean, as Australia integrates more with Asia and the Asian century, as Australia is seen as the great economic model. Do you think, you know, Jenny Buchan will be out advising other countries on the model and how you deal with these types of issues?
Logically, yes, because I'm the only lawyer, only law person anywhere in the world who has looked at franchising from the more holistic view of where does the franchisee sit within the big economic model. There are some really good franchise economists in the US, but they've never pursued the model through to franchisor failure. They've stopped with the assumption that the franchisor will continue to grow and succeed.
Fantastic. Well, Jenny, you've really started something new here in Australia that's of passionate interest to you, but it's also going to do a lot for, you know, the future of the Australian economy and hopefully other countries. So thank you and thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Tim.
Okay, I'll buy your book.
I'll buy yours.
Okay, great. Cool.